There is great concern in many European countries, especially those that border the Mediterranean Sea, over the influx of people seeking shelter from the still simmering Arab Spring. A mass exodus of refugees has been flooding the continent. This adds to the many reasons why radical right-wing parties who are anti-immigration, anti-diversity and anti-multiculturalism are popular at the polls in Europe today. Increased migration, especially when the citizens of a host country are suffering from more economic grievances, helps lay the groundwork for a nationalist, at times starkly chauvinist, revival. Right-wing extremism has been on the rise in Europe since the 1980s. Some analysts think that the current far-right revival has little to do with the return to fascism and Nazism of the 1930s and 40s. They mainly attribute this to the after-effects of the recent severe global financial crisis, including the painful and savage austerity measures imposed on millions of people. But others think that cultural protectionism and the dire need to act in defense of Christian or white racial identity are a more important factor inflaming a strong far-right sentiment. The European People's Party, EPP, is the largest and most influential European-level political party of the center-right. EPP President Wilfried Martens utterly rejects the political values of the far-right that threaten a democratic Europe. Wilfried Martens was one of the co-founders of the EPP in 1976, and he has seen it grow into the largest political movement of Europe. The EPP strives for a democratic, transparent, efficient and strong Europe, based on a federal model and close to its citizens. It seeks a prosperous Europe through the promotion of a free market economy with social consciousness. The EPP sees the Arab Spring as an excellent opportunity to further promote interfaith and intercultural dialogue, create real democracy in the Middle East, strengthen the Union for the Mediterranean, launched in 2008, as well as reshape and revitalize the European Neighborhood Policy, EMP, which is currently under review.
We developed, for instance, since 3 years, a dialogue, interreligious and intercultural. I came here a year ago in Cairo. I went to Amman in Jordan. I invited the King Abdullah to a summit meeting of the EPP with all our heads of state. And we signed a common declaration. And more important also, the whole Mediterranean Sea is a Mare Nostrum. It is our common sea. There are ties between Europe and the Arab countries and North Africa in this common Mediterranean Union. So that's one of the main goals of our political family and also of the European Union. And when we are speaking about the neighborhood policy for this Mediterranean Union, that is one of the most important objectives and goals of the European Union. So we share values with the United States of America and with Canada. But now, after the revolution, we want to share the same values also with your country and with the Arab countries. You cannot come to a real stability without democracy and without openness. And with the revolution in the Arab Spring, we have now the possibility, for the first time, to create this democracy, this rule of law. This is a real basis for stability. The stability of the past was not a real stability.
In recent years, far-right statements have appeared to lose much of their post-World War II taboo, even among some prominent political parties. There is also a focus in both Europe and the United States on Islamic terrorists, which has led to overlooking domestic terrorists. This might be one reason why Europe was in shock on realizing that a white Christian extremist, rather than a Muslim fundamentalist, committed the twin attacks in Norway in July 2011 that left nearly 100 dead. The mass murder was fueled by anti-Islamic sentiment. Whether or not the perpetrator acted alone or is a madman, the rise of far-right beliefs in mainstream politics has its own dire consequences. The center-right European People's Party started as a coalition of Christian Democrats who have been working together in Europe since 1947. Today, the EPP includes members from other parties like the Conservatives, Liberal Conservatives, and even parties that do not adhere to a particular religion. The lessons learnt from the First and Second World Wars have led to the EPP conviction that overcoming nationalism is the precondition for maintaining a lasting peace. Wilfried Martens explains that the EPP also believes in separation of church and state, and that its members are bound by universal rather than Christian values. He sees this as one important dilemma that the emerging political parties in post-Mubarak Egypt, especially those that group Islamist members, need to resolve among themselves.
We have a difficult task. We have a political party, European political party, where religion and political decisions are a very important challenge for us, and we developed to a party of values in the conviction that you can share and defend fundamental values on the basis of your personal religious conviction, but we are not in favor to create a clerical state or a religious state. This is a personal inspiration and motivation. What we do is create, and we created, a party of values, and we want that European Union is a union of values, defending values in Europe, but also everywhere in the world and also in this region.
There are many political parties that are being established in Egypt by, for instance, the Salafists, the Muslim Brotherhood, and the Liberals. How can the European People's Party cooperate with such a wide range of political parties, and what are your main areas of concern?
We are not cooperating at this moment. We had talks with some of them, for instance, with the party Justice and Freedom. No, Freedom and Justice. And with other parties, also with a lot of new parties. But these parties have also, as we have, are confronted with the whole question, what is the place of religion? Is it a personal inspiration? But we are in favor of separation of church and state. And the political decisions are taken by the politicians, not by religious people. We are totally autonomous. And we can do that because we are assembling people on the basis of values. And even non-believers can defend these values on the basis of other resources than their belief.
So which values are you talking about? Christian values?
No, universal values. Freedom and responsibility, solidarity, justice, for instance, are the main. These values, democracy, and in democracy, what we call subsidiarity, that means an organization of the state and authorities near to the people, decentralization, and so on and so on. But democracy is an essential value for us. And we mean that. And our political programs and our political action is based on these values. And we hope to share it also in the future with political actors and political parties here.
So why a coalition of mostly Christian Democrats? And how does the word Christian fit in the whole picture?
I am one of the founders of the party. The party was founded in 1976. What was the name of the party? European People's Party. At that moment, In 76, there were 6 member states in the European Union. We had the party then, EPP, European People's Party, was a federation of Christian democratic parties in Germany, in France, in Italy, in Belgium, in the Netherlands, and in Luxembourg. But with the enlargement of the European Union, we opened the party in the beginning of 1990 to other parties, conservative parties, people's parties, as the Partido Popular in Spain, for instance, social democratic parties in Portugal, and so on and so on. But on the basis of a new system of values we developed. So Christian Democrats are a part, the German Christian Democrats, the Belgian Christian Democrats, the Dutch Christian Democrats are member of the EPP, but also other parties, and we are united now on a system of values we are defending together. The French UMP party of President Sarkozy is a member of the EPP. It is not a Christian Democratic party, not at all. It is a like party, but they share with us the same values.
The influx of Muslim immigrants into Europe is rooted in the common human aspiration for a better life. But to date, there is no European consensus about how to deal with the political, social, religious, and economic problems associated with their integration. The EU countries have not ratified the 2003 United Nations International Convention on the Protection of the Rights of All Migrant Workers and Members of Their Families. And as much as there are fears about the rise of Islamophobia across Europe, there are great concerns about the increase of Europhobia in the sense that many Muslims are worried about losing their Islamic identity. All this complicates the integration process. Many observers think that in the next 10 years, more attacks like the ones that shocked Norway will occur by Islamic and Christian extremists. They believe that the Norway terrorist incidents highlight that Europe has been changing for quite a while, with a strong swing rightward. It's true that people have become a lot more open-minded and are more ready to accept different neighbors who may not look like them. But many observers still think that a lot more Europeans will be voting for populist or far-right parties compared to the past 10 years. Against this background, Peace in Focus conducted an exclusive interview with President of the center-right European People's Party, Wilfried Martens, in Cairo for more insights on the rise of right-wing extremism and Islam in Europe, as well as the repercussions of the Arab Spring. Wilfried Martens was the former Prime Minister of Belgium. He's married to former Belgian minister Miet Smet, an icon of women's emancipation. The EPP includes 75 member parties from 39 countries, as well as 17 EU and 6 non-EU heads of state and government. The European People's Party, whose roots run deep in the history and civilization of the European continent, has pioneered the European project since its inception in the 1950s. The EPP is currently leading the 3 main institutions of the European Union. The presidents of the European Commission, Council and Parliament are EPP members. 13 members of the European Commission are from the EPP, that also has the largest group in the European Parliament. The final EU decisions are usually formulated with the broadest possible consensus. They are influenced by the EPP and to a lesser extent by the main socialist and liberal parties. The European People's Party is horizontally engaged with all the main institutions of the European Union. It has its own political platform and positions and is not necessarily bound by the decisions of the EU institutions. For instance, the party's position is that the sound partnership between the European Union and post-Mubarak Egypt should be based on solidarity. According to EPP President Wilfried Martens, the party does not accept the condition of shared accountability outlined by President of the European Commission, José Manuel Barroso in his speech titled Partners in Freedom, the EU Response to the Arab Spring, that he delivered in Cairo in July 2011. Considering its strong political weight, the EPP may significantly influence the future policy of the European Union towards the Arab and Islamic worlds.
The title was, was Partners in Freedom. Partners in Freedom. I don't like shared accountability. I think that the subtitle of his speech was Partners in Freedom. And he declared we are here to listen, not to lecture. And solidarity is a basic principle of the European Union.
Joining Peace in Focus is His Excellency Mr. Wilfried Martens, President of the European People's Party. Your Excellency, thank you so much for joining Peace in Focus. Good to have you, sir.
Thank you.
Egypt is exploring all tracks to prepare for its parliamentary and presidential elections. There is certainly no one right recipe for a successful transition, and every country is unique. But still, there are lessons to be learned from other countries. I understand that EPP helped post-communist countries while undergoing democratic transition. How can Egypt learn from Europe's 1989 revolutions, and what are the mistakes that should be avoided?
It took 10 years before we came to a stable political landscape in Central Europe. The advantage also was that at a certain moment, since 2004, these countries became, in one decision, all members of the European Union, 10 countries. I will always remember that day, the 1st of May 2004. The second element is that during that period of transition, there is a risk that political parties are formed on the basis of a personality, an individual. And the result of this is after a certain period, these parties have no content. You have to create parties with a content. And you can do that when you are members of a regional or international organization. Not only for that reason, but the examples of parties becoming democratic parties, as in Central Europe, can be an example. And when you are member of, when you have a partnership with parties, as we have in Europe, for instance, but also in other continents, that can help you to form parties with the content, with the conviction. And this is essential to come to stable, to a stable political landscape and to stable political parties.
You were twice in office as the Prime Minister of Belgium that hosts the EU headquarters. In your autobiography, you offer the inside story on running a complex country like Belgium. And I understand that your party is playing a pivotal role in resolving the Belgian problem. What are the details and how can Egypt learn from Belgium's experience?
My country, Belgium, is a country in diversity with three official languages. Dutch for the Flemish, French for the Walloons and the French speaking, and German for a German community in Belgium, only 62,000 people, but they have their own regional parliament and also regional government. So to create not only cohabitation, living together, we come from an unitarian state without decentralization, with only French in the past as official language. And so the two other languages were recognized, Dutch for the Flemish and German for the German-speaking community. And we made a federal state. So this is an enormous project. It took 30 years. It is not yet completely finished. It will be finished, I hope, in the next years. We had also contradictions in our country between public schools and confessional schools. We had the school war in the 19th century, in the 20th century. We realized compromises and we have now peace. in the school system. To give you two examples, that was an enormous advantage for the political people in Belgium on the European scene. We are the people of making compromises, good compromises, we hope. And we were always very European-minded for that reason. We are the center of Europe. Brussels is de facto, is in fact, the capital of the European Union. And a lot of our politicians played a very important role in the European construction. So you can learn from your differences, from your distinctions, from the fact that you are speaking several languages, that you're coming from several cultures, has not to be a source of division and of catastrophe, but the reason for understanding, to come to consensus, to coalitions, to form governments. This was the advantage, and especially on the European level, we could use our experience in Belgium.
Is Belgium really succeeding, sir, in resolving its own problem?
We are one of the richest countries in Europe. I will not tell you that there are no risks. There are risks. And a lot of people, the radical and the extremist people in our country, still try to divide the country. It is not, but an enormous majority of the people, on the basis of all opinion polls, are in favor to maintain the country, but a new country. A country after a sort of revolution. Well, that is not a revolution. A long way of reforms, a long way of reforms to come to a real federal state, but in solidarity. In solidarity. Always the same value is coming back.
EPP is the largest and most influential European-level political party of the center-right. Some analysts say that the recent twin attacks in Norway that were carried out by a Christian right-wing extremist with anti-Muslim views raise concerns about the rise of right-wing violence in Europe. Your take on this?
That is correct. You see, this was perhaps a crazy man. But we are fighting against extremism. And we are fighting what is called populism. Populism, for instance, you have extreme right parties. You have, as in the Netherlands, anti-Muslim parties. You have pure populist parties. And especially our political family, in the political landscape in the center-right, is attacked and can lose voters to the extremists. And more than that, these populist parties are denying the values on which the European Union has been constructed. So they are our real, not only competitors, they try to deny the values on which, after two world wars, Europe could find peace, reconciliation after the recent Second World War, and they try to deny it. So we have to struggle against them.
The European People's Party, a coalition of mainly Christian Democrats, is involved in interfaith dialogue with Muslims around the world. How can Muslims deal with anti-Islam right-wingers in Europe?
They cannot. But our task and our responsibility is not only to have the dialogue, as we are doing since some years, and coming here as I did also last year, before the event here, but we have to create, in our public opinion, the conscience that we have to be not only tolerant, that we have to respect all religions, to give them the opportunity also for their religion, to express their faith in their religion. We have to create a public opinion which accept this. This is essential. This is linked to the values of the European Union. Take the European Treaty. It is in Article 2 of this treaty.
Switzerland is not a member of the European Union, and the Swiss People's Party, also known as the Democratic Union of the Center, is not a member of EPP. But what do you think of what has been happening over the past years? The Swiss People's Party supported the successful 2009 Anti-Minarett Initiative, and then we had the Ausschaffungs Initiative, or the 2010 Black Sheep Campaign on deporting foreign criminals. And today, there is public debate on banning the hijab or the headscarf in the public sphere.
I cannot agree with these measures. So I think a lot of people also in my country have a nuanced conviction about it. But this type of actions will not bring stability and peace and reconciliation in our society. We are living, in fact, in a multicultural society in Europe. And there are 6 million Muslims in France, there are 5 million Muslims in Germany, in the big cities of Europe. And so we have to create a society which accepts this, accepts the identity and the cultural differences, and tries to live together in peace and in cooperation. And I know these type of measures are taken because of internal political questions, essentially, but that will not help us. This is also a lesson for your countries to accept the same rule and to give also an example.
Some analysts think that if Egypt is lucky, the country's future will look most like Turkey, a functioning democracy with a strong Islamist party and a booming economy. Your take on this?
Since 10 years, we are working together with AKP in Turkey. It was perhaps not easy. It was perhaps difficult at a certain moment. But now it is clear that we were right, and that the creation of the AKP party in Turkey was a fantastic political new phenomenon and very important. And the events now in the Arab countries prove that it is possible in a good synthesis, symbiose, as we discussed about religious inspiration, but autonomous, independent decision-making in politics is possible. Accepting the separation of church and state, what is the case in Turkey? And even in an extra-constitutional disposition in Turkey. So it is possible. And AKP is playing now a very important role as an example of what could happen also in the Arab countries, realizing their spring.
Your Excellency, what do you think of the Arab Spring?
The Arab Spring, as one of our colleagues, Senator McCain in the United States declared, the Arab Spring is the repudiation of Al-Qaeda. That's a fantastic expression.
Is the Arab Spring changing the negative perception of Islam caused by the September 11 attacks against the United States?
Absolutely. And so it is the negation of what happened with Al-Qaeda. And it gives a totally other image of the Muslim religion, the Muslim culture, together with European integration. European integration, as we did after the Second World War, creating Europe on the basis of values, and the Arab Spring, if the ideals and the goals are implemented, is an historical event as important as European integration.
Your Excellency, Mr. Wilfried Martens, President of the European People's Party, thank you so much for speaking to Peace and Focus. It has been interesting talking to you, sir.
Thank you for this invitation.